Once again, we're in 2 Timothy chapter 1. We're going to read verses 11 through 12. And the title of the message this morning is, I Know in Whom I Have Believed. Now, like I said, whether or not my message really connects to the title or not, I hope it does in some way, shape, or form. But I know that essentially I'm really going to preach to you the essence of the whole book of 2 Timothy this morning. So let's go ahead and read this passage of Scripture. It says, Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. So really, before we move on, let me just give this one little preface statement. That the Apostle Paul is writing this letter to a young pastor named Timothy. I'm sure many of you know that. For the longest time, when I didn't really know much about the Bible, I thought Timothy wrote the book, for all I knew. But the Apostle Paul wrote two letters to this young pastor named Timothy. He wrote 1 and 2 Timothy to him. And now we're going to get into the context of where Paul is in the midst of this life, in his life when he writes this letter. But right now, just be aware that this is what he's doing. He's addressing young Timothy as a pastor in this letter. So he says, Now be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and hath brought to life and immortality to light through the gospel. Whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. So in order to really be able to get a revelation of what Paul's talking about when he says, I know in whom I have believed, we really have to once again gain an understanding of where Paul is when he writes this letter. I've shared some of these concepts with the church on a couple of different occasions, but one thing that I need you to know is that the internal evidence, when you read this whole book for yourself, what you'll be, and if you also read 1 Timothy, and also even in the book of Acts, when it mentions Timothy, and also I believe in the first part of Galatians, it mentions Timothy. When you bring all of this evidence together, what you begin to realize is that Timothy was a young man called by God, without a doubt, had a gift of God placed on his life. He was called to preach the gospel. Paul saw that. Paul laid hands on him and said, basically saying, the Holy Spirit has called you to preach the gospel, young man. You need to go forth and do the work of the Lord. Amen. But at the same time, we see from the internal evidence that Timothy, he may have been even a little bit sickly physically. The Bible talks about in 1 Timothy that Paul exhorted him not to just take water with his meal, but a little bit of wine, not for the purpose that he might get drunk. Come on, somebody, help me out here. But that he had some type of an infirmity, something going on, and that it was going to help him in some shape, way, shape, or form, probably something to do with the water back in those days or whatever the case was causing problems with him. Nevertheless, he had some type of a physical infirmity, but not only that, he seemed to be timid. It seems as though other people that were rising up as so-called leaders were able to intimidate young Timothy. And he felt because of his youth that he didn't have a right to stand up in certain circumstances. The Apostle Paul is writing this letter for the purpose of encouraging him and exhorting him and letting him know, listen to me, Timothy, you've been called to preach the gospel. You can't be timid. You can't be full of fear. You need to stand up, rise up, and do what it is that God has called you to do. The context of where we are in this passage of Scripture is that this is the end of Paul's life. This is the last letter that he will ever write. This is the last address to the church that we'll ever hear from the great Apostle Paul. As we know, the story that he was on the road to Damascus, really heading to modern-day Turkey or Syria, if you will, in order to gain letters from the Jewish leaders before his conversion, in order to put Christians in prison, in order to have Christians killed, because he was zealous for the law and he was zealous for the Jewish religion. On the way to the road to Damascus, a bright light shined from heaven, and it was so bright and intense that it knocked the Apostle Paul, his name at that time was Saul, to the ground. Then a voice spoke from heaven and said, Saul, that was his name, Saul, why do you kick against the pricks? The idea was a prick was also another name for a goad, and I've shared this with you before, but it was a pointed instrument that was used to stab animals in their hindquarters to make them move in the right direction. The idea was that God had been for quite some time, like almost with a goad, or in modern day it'd be an electric prod, prodding the Apostle Paul, trying to get him to go in the right direction. But what he was doing was like a wild animal kicking against the goad, kicking against the direction that God had been instructing him to go. And his response to the Lord was, who are you, Lord? And Jesus spoke and said, I'm Jesus of Nazareth, the one whom you persecute. And we know the story that he became blinded and that he ended up in a place called a street called Straight. And God called another disciple named Ananias to come and to lay hands upon the Apostle Paul. And when he did, the scales fell from his eyes. The Bible said he was filled with the Holy Ghost and that he straightway or immediately began to preach Jesus in the synagogues. It turned the whole Christian world, the whole Jewish world of that area upside down. They didn't Amen. Know what to do. They were full of fear. This is the man that used to kill us. This is the man that gave consent to Stephen's death. And he sat there and he watched the rocks hit Stephen in the face as that first martyr for Jesus died right there in the field as the rocks hit him. What are we to do? He's a murderous. And now he says he's one of us. And he continued to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you follow the book of Acts, that's really where in the first portion of the book of Acts, Peter is, I don't want to say it this way, but I don't know any other way to say it. He's kind of like the headline of the show. You know, it's like everything's focused on Peter in the first portion of the book of Acts. But after Saul's conversion, now Paul begins to be the emphasis of the New Testament building of the church. And I've shared this with you before. He's going on missionary journeys, whether it be on foot, whether it be by sea. He goes on at least three different missionary journeys on boats in the Mediterranean, covering Asia Minor, Greece, even making it to Rome by way of prison. Really and truly, that's where we are right here. There's something that took place around Acts chapter 19 where the Apostle Paul is just going through Asia Minor. I mean, not to try to get technical on you, but to remind you, you know, where is Asia Minor? This is our map of what, you know, Israel would have been. Jerusalem would have been down here. And then there was an isthmus of land. It's a strip of land. This was called Asia Minor. Okay, and this is where the seven churches of the book of Revelation are located, in this strip of land right here. And then over here we would have Italy, something like that. And then over here we would have the area of Greece. This is just kind of like, you know, just giving you a little bit of an idea of an overall map. Egypt would be down here, Babylon over here, modern day Iran somewhere around here. And so essentially what's going on is that there was a church around in this area here called Ephesus. All right, it was one of the seven churches of the book of Revelation. But while the Apostle Paul was over there ministering at one point in time, he's preaching the gospel. He's letting people know you're believing in false gods. You're believing in pagan deities. The God that I serve conquered death, hell, and the grave. The God that I serve, he resurrected from the dead. Death can't hold him down. Amen. He paid the penalty for sin. And because he paid the penalty for sin, death and the grave couldn't hold him down. He resurrected. He offers eternal life to anyone who would believe in him. And the result of that is that people began to believe the gospel and it began to transform their lives. So much so, I'm trying to give you a picture of what the ministry that the Holy Spirit did through him. People started getting converted. Let me tell you something. When you get converted, when the Holy Ghost shows up on the inside of your life, I'm not going to sit here and tell you you're a perfect man, but what I'm here to tell you is that you become changed. The Holy Spirit moves in and he begins to deal with the internal aspects of the heart. And what happened was, is the Bible says that they started to take all of their stuff that they had previously from all their curious arts, whether they were books, whether they were talismans or various little articles, And they began to heap them in piles and they set them ablaze. And the next thing you know, there was a man named Demetrius. He was a silversmith. And he made much money baking idols unto Diana, who was the goddess of Ephesus. And he became angry. And he began to cause a tumult or a riotous problem as he began to say, this man Paul, not only in Ephesus, but in all of Asia Minor, he begins to speak these things of this Jesus, and now he's desecrating our goddess Diana, and a big uproar took place, and they ended up ultimately arresting the Apostle Paul. This started him on a long journey of imprisonment and where he was imprisoned there, and he was taken by ship ultimately to Jerusalem and then back all the way to Rome to stand before Caesar. But this took place for many, many years. Then he was released, according to Jewish tradition, or to the church tradition. He was released from Rome, which at that point in time he was actually under house arrest, where people were able to come visit him, and he was able to still preach the gospel, but he was released for a period of time, and now the tradition goes that he was arrested again in Rome while Nero was emperor. He writes 2 Timothy while he's arrested and imprisoned in Rome while Nero is emperor. Things got really bad for Christians during Nero's rise as emperor. See, there was you hear of the story that Rome caught ablaze. Rome was caught on fire and it burned for 6 days and six nights. And the people, because of how cruel Nero was, believed at first that he was the one that caused it to happen. He was so cruel in his torture and the things that he did that the people really believed Nero was behind it, just because he wanted to watch Rome burn, because that's how sick he was. Well, he flipped the script because he hated Christians, and he began to haul up Christians and torture them and made them bring a confession, as the story goes. There's actually a written document from that time. And the guy wasn't even a Christian. He actually, the way he speaks of the Christians, he said their leader, this Christus, died in Jerusalem. And yet they followed him. And they didn't even believe in, he didn't even believe in Jesus. And even the people at that time, many of them didn't believe in Jesus or follow the Lord. But they saw the cruelty with which Nero was treating them. And they said, this is a travesty. He did things to these Christians like cover them in animal fur and throw them in an arena with wild beasts. He would cover them with pitch or tar and set them ablaze. He even did it in his own gardens, where he would cover them with pitch and set them ablaze so that it would provide night lights for him to be able to see into his gardens at night. This is the kind of atmosphere that's going on. Paul now is imprisoned in Rome in a prison called the Mamertine Prison. It's like a dungeon. It's a pit that's dug deep down into the ground. It's damp. It's wet. It's poorly lit as far as light goes. And he's writing this letter in the midst of all of this. And what I need you to know is that his concern is not really for himself.
Amen.
You can see little spots where it looks as though he's probably lonely. You can see little spots where it's obvious that people have come against him and his heart's been hurt. But ultimately, the emphasis of his letter is the gospel must go forward.
Hallelujah.
In each and every chapter that you begin to read in this book, he references the gospel, the importance of doctrine, the importance of instruction. And essentially, this is what I believe I want to share with you this morning, what the Holy Spirit wants me to share with you this morning, the importance of the scripture and our understanding of the Bible and our understanding of our relationship with God in the midst of the world that we live in, what's really important versus what we focus on many times that's not really that important in the midst of our lives. Amen? And so that's what I really want you to see, is that even in the midst of all of this pain, all of this heartache that's taking place, the Apostle Paul can say, I'm not ashamed. I sit down here in this dungeon at the bottom of this pit, and I'm not ashamed. For I know in whom I have believed. No matter what you go through in this life, your little vapor of life that you're going to be given a certain amount of time, you're going to experience heartache, You're going to experience tragedy. You're going to experience bad things in the midst of your life. How do I know that? Oh, you're preaching a negative confession. Preacher, no, I'm not. I'm preaching you the truth. The world that we live upon is in a fallen state. Because of Adam's disobedience towards God, the entirety of the human race has been infected, if you will, with this thing called a sinful nature. And everywhere we turn, we see pain that abounds. The Bible says that the truth of the matter is that all creation groans waiting for the redemption of the sons of man. What does that mean? That means that the reason that the tree rots is because of the fall of man. That means the reason that you see a dead bird on the side of the road every now and then when you're walking down the road is because of the fall of man. There would be no heartache, there would be no disease, there would be no pain upon this earth had it not been for the fall of man. And the entirety of the creation instinctually knows that. That's why the bird sings. He's longing for, that's what I believe anyway. The bird sings because he longs for the return of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The animal creation longs and waits for the arrival of the Lord and for the redemption of the sons of men. What does that mean? The finality where you and I take off this tent, put on the new tent, receive our glorified body, and the fulfillment of the age is done. You might not be waiting for that, Christian, but I'm here to tell you this world is crying out for it and longing for God to turn the page and get to the final chapter. Hallelujah. Amen. And so now I want to just kind of read. Really, I want to start off at the end of the letter, and then I want to go through each chapter, and I want to kind of show you where he mentions various aspects about the gospel. But here's the end of the letter, and we can get a little bit of a picture of how the Apostle Paul is feeling. And as we read, it's 2 Timothy chapter 4, starting in verse 6, and we'll go through 17. I'm just going to kind of give a little bit of commentary as we go through, okay? He says in verse 6, starting off in verse 6, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." Hallelujah. You see, in the midst of this first part of what he's saying is, this is where I am, this is what I'm dealing with right here. But one thing that I know is that now I'm ready to be offered. The idea behind being offered is like a drink offering. It's one of these portions of one of the old Levitical sacrifices where a hin of wine was poured upon the altar as the animal was sacrificed. It's all part of the Levitical sacrifices. And all of those go back to foreshadowing or showing us Jesus. What the Apostle Paul is saying right here is that this isn't an execution that's about to happen to me. Church tradition says that the Apostle Paul, not long after he wrote this letter, was beheaded according to Nero's orders, that Paul was beheaded for the faith, okay? But what he knows that. He knows that his time is near, and he's going to be offered up. So he's saying, this isn't an execution. In reality, what's going to happen here is that just as Jesus was sacrificed for me, my life, for what I have done for the Lord, will also in turn be sacrificed for him and for his cause. He goes on to say that my departure is at hand. That word departure in the Greek has a couple of different ideas, and we'll just focus on two of them. One is that it's like a ship where the anchor has been lifted and it's ready to set sail. Another one is like a tent that's being torn down because you're moving on to another place. So the ship, whenever the Apostle Paul looks at this, he's not so stricken with fear that his mind cannot continue to think about the kingdom. But the reality of it is that he looks at it at the end of a voyage. It's the end of a journey. It's the next leg in the finality of a journey. He's looking for that celestial city, that city that Abraham looked for, amen, whose builder and maker was God, praise God. Paul is looking to move forward and to sail into the next portion of his life. He understands that this is the end, but that by the grace of God, he's been faithful. He's fought the fight. He ran the race. He didn't drag up I don't mean to be funny, but he didn't drag up and he pulled a hamstring right there in the middle of the race. Oh, and I just can't make it to the end. No, through the beatings, through the lashings, through the torture, through the stonings, through the shipwrecks, through the imprisonments, he never gave up. By the grace of God, he continued on. Why? So that he could preach the gospel and tell others the truth. And the tent portion is this. He talks about it in the book of 1 Corinthians. It talks about taking off the tent and putting on a new one, a tabernacle. The idea is that this earthly body represents our earthly tent, but that whenever we move on to the next life, we're going to receive a glorified one. That's what the Apostle Paul is talking about. He's about to be offered up as a sacrifice, but he sees where God is bringing him, and he looks forward to it. He says that there's going to be laid up for me a crown of righteousness. The word there in the Greek, I preached on this one time, is called the Stephanos. It's the victor's crown. It's that wreath that they would wear around their head, but this one is as it is an eternal crown that's going to be able to be laid back at the feet of his Savior. Now look at what, and he says the righteous judge is going to give me on that day. The Apostle Paul is in prison for preaching the truth. The Apostle Paul is in prison for letting those that are dying in a lost and dying world to know the truth, to give them the hope of glory. Yet unrighteous judges have placed him in a place where he really isn't supposed to be. But he knows that I don't have to fear these judges, because the eternal judge, the righteous judge, he sees all, he knows all. He's watched me run this race. This is what he says to Timothy in the next sentence. Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. Look why. For Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed into Thessalonica. Crescens, another person, to Galatia. Titus unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. You know, there was a time, in you may remember in the book of Acts, whenever Mark and Barnabas had been on a missionary journey, and Barnabas and Paul had been on a missionary journey, and they brought John Mark with them, who was Barnabas's nephew. And in the middle of the journey, Mark pulled up. I guess he pulled a hamstring or something. He pulled up and he said, I got to go back home. And then it came time to go on another missionary journey. And Paul said, we ain't bringing that boy with us. Because, I mean, he's not ready. He drunk up the last time and he's going to put us in a bind again. And it was so bad that it caused a dispute between Paul and Barnabas. They went their separate ways. And Paul ended up taking Silas with him and Barnabas took Mark with him. But now what's happened is that Mark has proven himself. It encourages me to know that, you know, the truth of the matter is that if you drag up on me, I'm probably going to think that way in the back of my head. I realize now as I read the scripture, it's not right. Amen. But if you drag up on me, I'm probably going to think that way in the back of my head. I trusted you. I was depending on you. And there you. But you see, the truth of the matter is that God knows how to get a hold of people. And he obviously got a hold of John Mark. And he put some fortitude in him. He put a backbone in him. And now he's proven himself in such a way that Paul said, bring him with you when you come, because he's profitable to me for ministry. I've watched his life since that day. Hallelujah. God, man might give up on you. I'm just here to tell you, but God will never give up on you if you have a desire to serve him and to walk with him and to do his will. Amen. Yeah. He will not give up on you, so you keep on holding on to him. But we see where all these people have forsaken him. The only one that's there is Luke. He says, and Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when you come, bring with thee, and the books, but especially the parchments. It's cold. You know, I've told you all that part before. You need to bring that cloak that I left over there. I wish I had it with me. I could use a blanket right now. And I need the parchments. I need the books. I want to still study. He's focused on things having to do with the scripture. Even in the midst of all of this, he writes this letter. He's concerned about the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's concerned about the work of God going forth. He says right here in the next sentence, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Of whom be thou aware. That's also like a word. Be aware. Beware, Timothy. Also, for he has greatly withstood our words. Listen to me. I'm about to go on, and you're going to be left. And you need to be aware that Alexander the coppersmith is still out there, and he just represents one. There's many of them that withstand our words. The words that God has given us, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let me tell you something, when you begin to stand for the truth of the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, and that you can't do it on your own, your works aren't going to sanctify you, but it's the work of the finished work of Jesus. And as you keep your faith in that, then it releases the Holy Spirit to do a work on the inside of you, to strengthen you, to empower you, and to do a work in you that no man, no pastor, no counselor, no one else, no couch, no drug, no psychiatrist is ever going to be able to fix the things that ail the human heart other than Jesus Christ. And the only way you're going to be able to receive the access is if you keep your faith in God's eternal redemption plan. But it's contrary to what the modern church teaches. It's contrary to what the church was teaching back then. They were teaching that you have things you have to do. You have to circumcise yourself. You have to keep the law. You have to do these rules and regulations. No! Jesus did the work, hallelujah. And when you begin to tell the truth, people like Alexander the coppersmith will withstand your words, and they'll have something to say about you behind your back. They'll talk to others about you. You got to learn how to not get so consumed. And Lord, I'm speaking to myself right now with what other people are saying. Stay focused, stay steadfast, and move forward with what God has called you to do. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. And you know, there's one spot in here, I didn't put it in the notes, but where the Apostle Paul talks about, he talks about the fact that whenever you're correcting someone, essentially this is the idea anyway, you need to correct them, not so much with contentiousness, but really with meekness.
Right.
Because the hope is that you save them from themselves. What's really happening is, and that spoke to me, and it kind of actually started to mess with my heart a little bit. In other words, the idea is you can sit here, you can have a debate with everybody, you can withstand them to their face, you can speak harsh words because you think you're defending the faith. The reality of it is this: they are opposing their own selves. If they are opposing the words of the gospel, they don't even know any better. It can be another preacher. They don't even know any better. But the idea is that their soul might be saved, that they might come to an understanding of the truth of the gospel. And the Apostle Paul is saying you need to approach it in a way that you're really wanting them to turn from the way that they're going, that they would repent from that way, and that they would come over to the truth. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. And he goes on to say, look at this. Next sentence. At my first answer, or really probably having to do with whenever all of this first happened, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. Praise God. The Apostle Paul, I mean, if you could see him, you're not going to tell me that he wasn't hurt by it. He's a human being. Everybody that he had helped before, now listen to me, there were leaders in the church of Ephesus that Paul was close to. It was in Ephesus that he stood up to Demetrius the silversmith, and none of them old boys are over there visiting him. Nobody from Asia Minor, nobody from Ephesus is hanging out at the prison. There's one person in here that he mentions, and I didn't bring it up, Onesiphorus, who's over there, and he's helping Paul, and he's ministering in Rome with Paul, and he's probably going back and trying to talk to him through the prison. Hey, this is what happened today. Give me some, and he's working with him in ministry, there to encourage him. Luke is there to encourage him in visiting him, but everybody else has forsaken. All the people that he's poured his life into, all the people that and you remember how he started the letter off to Timothy? Don't be ashamed of the gospel. Don't be ashamed of me, the prisoner of the Lord. Amen. You will suffer affliction for the gospel's sake. And that's what he was saying as far as for Alexander the Great. And remember, not Alexander the Great, Alexander the coppersmith. And he talked about that he was getting ready to depart from there. But one of the things that I mentioned early on was that every chapter has to do with the importance of preaching and teaching and the maintenance of good doctrine. And he's encouraging young Timothy to move forward. Let's go back to 2 Timothy chapter 1, and we'll start off in verse 3. And we'll read through 12 again. But this time, the first time I was just kind of introducing to you the idea of what Paul was doing. And now I kind of just want to look at things a little bit more closely, what the words are saying. The Apostle Paul says, I thank God whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience. You know what that means? The Apostle Paul was from the tribe of Benjamin. And he would have learned the ways of the Jews from his forefathers, and he served God the best way he knew how as a Jew. But then now, the fulfillment of the revelation of Jesus Christ, who was the promised one, has entered into his heart. He's saying, I've been serving God, as far as what I've known, ever since I was a young boy. And he's approaching Timothy, and he's setting that up. He says, now without ceasing, I have remembrance of you, Timothy, in my prayers, night and day. Greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of your tears. He's probably saying the last time we saw each other, whenever we departed, I can remember the tears in your eyes. That I may be filled with joy when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee. You know what the word unfeigned means? It means non-hypocritical. The word hypocrite is hypokritos in the Greek. This word here is ahypokritos, meaning a means without. You don't have hypocrisy in your faith. I've watched your life. There's a lot of people that show up and they say one thing, and in reality, their heart's doing something different. Timothy, I know your life. I know what you're doing. I know you love God and that you have an unhypocritical faith that is in you. It says, look right here, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I am persuaded that in you also, wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee, by the putting on of my hand. So one of the things that we see right here is the importance of parents to instill to their children the truth of the gospel. No matter what you think is important in life, and I'm here to tell you right now that we've all been guilty of that. We have all of these ideas that we want to make for our kids, but the most important, like what their career is going to be, sending them, you know, making sure they go into the best schools or whatever we're trying to do for them, I'm here to tell you that the most important thing that we can do as parents is to instill in them the truth of the gospel, because there's going to come a day when they're going to have to make choices on their own whether or not they're going to serve God or not. Eunice can't make Timothy serve God. His mama can't make Timothy serve God. But the reality of it is that they implanted truths of the gospel on the inside of his life. And now Paul is saying, hey, stir up the gift that has been placed in you. He's, once again, he's bringing it back to preaching the gospel. There's been a gift that's been placed in you. And he says right here, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind.
Amen.
Once again, this gives us the idea that Timothy probably has a problem with timidity. He probably has a problem with men that have been in the faith longer than him, you know, and them exerting their presence over him and him wanting to shrink back in fear. But the Apostle Paul saying that's not of the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God, he hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. You know, I just wanted to share with the congregation that I know that everybody's not called to stand behind the pulpit. I have certainly seen, just in my little short time of preaching, where people have tried to come against me and have tried to, you know, make me shrink back or whatever, not to stand strong on what it was that I knew that the Lord had showed me. Amen. But it's not just for the preacher. This goes for each and every one of us. Anytime any one of us makes a decision to take a stand for Jesus Christ and his gospel, and we say, you know what? No, I'm going to live for the Lord. And not only that, I'm going to be a witness for him in my own way. In the own circumstances that God provides for me, I'm going to be a witness for him. I can assure you, the enemy of your soul will fight you tooth and nail. He will try to strike you with a spirit of fear. He will try to make you timid. He will try to shut your mouth. He will try to cause all kind of havoc and chaos to take place in the midst of your life to get your eyes off of the prize, to get your eyes off of what is important, to make you shrink back from moving forward with what God has called you to do. The same word that Paul gave Timothy is the same word that the Lord would speak to us. I haven't given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. Amen. Remember what your purpose upon this earth is, and wherever God has placed you, Whatever the circumstance, you need to learn, amen, by the grace of God, to be a witness for Him. He said right here, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Now let's just slow down for a second. Let's look at that. He gave this to us. It's His own purpose, His own grace. He gave this to us in Christ Jesus before the world even began. This goes back to the idea out of 1 Peter 1:18, where the scripture says, you weren't redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold, but by the precious blood of a lamb, which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. God knew when He formed Adam out of clay, before He ever spoke the world into existence, before He ever molded Adam out of clay, before He ever breathed life into Adam's nostrils, that Adam was going to go the way of the serpent, that the fall was going to take place, that the entirety of the human race was going to be born of Adam, born in sin. Before that ever happened, God already had a plan in place. The plan was Jesus Christ. Paul now has received a revelation of that. Amen. Paul's the one that sees it. Amen? Paul is the one in the New Testament that makes all the connections that all the Old Testament sacrifices were types of Jesus. Paul's the one that says, He's our Passover. Our Passover has been crucified for us. It's the Holy Spirit that revealed these things to the Apostle Paul. He was able to knit the two testaments together and to be able to see the big picture of God, that this wasn't just an accident. This wasn't a hiccup on a stage of life. No, God was planning this from the beginning. Amen. And this is the gospel that we preach. He says, and now it's been made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ. He finally showed up. The prophets told us He was coming, and now He has showed up. He's been made manifest, amen, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, amen. He abolished death. The wages of sin is death. Mankind has been faced with the evil of sin, and man after man, woman after woman has faced the eternal death. But Jesus, who had no sin, died as a sacrifice in place of man's sin, and because sin had no right to hold Him down, He resurrected from the dead. He has abolished the power of death. This is the gospel that I preach, young Timothy. Let it be stirred up in you by the laying on of hand, the gift that is in you, let it be stirred up in you. Don't be timid. Don't shrink back. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And every man, woman, and child, every human being that has ever walked the face of the earth has a right to hear this gospel message so that their life might not be destroyed, that they might not be eternally separated from the presence of God. God has a plan, and He wants that plan communicated to a lost and a dying world. Praise God. And it all has to come through the light of the gospel. As a young boy, Timothy, I mean, if you think about it, Timothy, you can't shrink back. As a young boy, you were blessed with a grandmother that knew the scriptures. Your mama got saved because of that. And now you were privileged enough to grow up in a home where the gospel was being preached, where the truth was being told. And you have a responsibility now to tell others about the good news. He goes on to say in verses 11 and 12, and this was our passage where we started, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that He's able to keep that which I have committed unto Him against that day. I was just doing what God called me to do. I was just doing what He called me to do. When I showed up in Ephesus and I preached Jesus, I was just doing what God told me to do. It's not my fault that the Holy Spirit responds to truth. It's not my fault that the Holy Spirit began to move upon people's hearts and save their lives, and they threw down their curious arts and their magical spells and their books and all that other garbage and began to burn it. It's not my fault. This is God, the God of the universe's will that Diana be forsaken. It's the God of the universe's will that Demetrius the silversmith's shop be shut down. God, hallelujah, is the one that's worthy to be exalted. He's the one that's worthy to be glorified. I was just doing what God called me to do. I am not ashamed of these bonds. I am not ashamed of the predicament that I find myself in. I know in whom I have believed. It's important that you and I know in whom we have believed. The reason I say that is this. I can assure you, when the Apostle Paul first gave his heart to Jesus, and even before that, he didn't plan on his life ending in a dungeon in Rome. I can assure you, he didn't plan on getting his back beat as many times as it did. His head beaten with rods, shipwrecked, imprisoned, stoned. I can assure you that that's not what he intended for his life. He was on the fast track to becoming the leader of the Pharisees. He didn't expect, and what I'm trying to say to you is this. Many times when you enter into real Christianity, you're going to find situations in your life that you didn't expect things to turn out the way that they did. Sometimes I find things in my life that I don't expect them to turn out the way that they did. But the reality of it is this. I know one thing. I know in whom I have believed. God has revealed himself to me. He's revealed himself to me in a way that I know that he's real. And I know one thing. There's no going back. There's nothing back out there for me to go to. God has revealed himself to me in such a way that anybody can be deceived. Anybody can fall away from the Lord. He who thinks he stands, take heed lest he fall. Don't come in your relationship with God puffed up and full of pride. But the reality of it is this. I know in whom I have believed. He is real. He has revealed himself. If you are truly saved and the Holy Spirit has moved into your heart, you know what I'm talking about. Amen. You know that he's real. You know that he will work in your life. You got to continue to trust him. No matter, it doesn't matter whether it goes the way you want it to or not.
Amen.
I mean, will he clean up the mess? Yes. But how many times do we blame him for the mess? look at this mess in my life. And we want to blame the Lord. Hold on a second. Time out, Hoss. God didn't do this. No. You made choices. I made choices. The choices that we made caused catastrophe, chaos, destruction in the midst of our lives. You know what the Lord showed me a long time ago when he started giving me revelation about the Word of God? About the new man. About a new man in Christ. About his mind being renewed and operating and ordering his steps a different way than the way that he used to. The Lord showed me something. He said, son, he said, for 15 years or however many years, maybe not that long, a long time. From the age of 13, from the age of 13 to the age of 19. That doesn't seem like that long, but 6 years of some pretty messed up stuff. 6 years, you lived your life any way that you wanted to do. Whatever you wanted to do, you just grabbed a hold of it and you went knee deep into it, just whatever you wanted to do. And your mindset was built upon that. And then you gave your heart to me, and now you think that in a week, 2 weeks, that everything's going to be normal? No. You lived like the old man for so long, that's all you knew. That was what was in your heart, that was in your mind. You think you love, you've been thinking you love me, you've been thinking you know my ways, you don't know my ways. You need to learn of my ways. It takes time for you to learn of my ways. And as you learn of my ways, I will reveal truth to you, I will minister to you, I will speak to you, and I will change your direction. Hallelujah. But you're going to have to stay on the path. You're going to have to stay on the path, and you're going to have to continue to follow me, no matter whether or not it goes the way that you want it to or not. And that just ought to make sense. The Apostle Paul could have quit. You know what? I ain't writing no letter. Nero's taking my head off next week. I ain't even worried about it. This is how God wants to treat me in the midst of all this? Forget it. Forget him. I quit. And I'm going to go have me a little pity party, and I'll just get my head cut off. And you know what? Luke probably won't even show up for the parade on that one. But no, that's not what he did. He said, you know what, Lord? I know in whom I have believed. Do you know in whom you have believed this morning? Some of you are shaking your head yes because you know that it's true because you know it in your knower. Some of you, maybe you're still trying to figure in your heart and in your mind, are you real, Lord? You know what? God's not scared about that. He's not up there biting his fingernails. Oh, Lord, you know, Robert's still not quite certain. He's still kind of on the edge there. No, he's okay. God's still on the throne. He knows how to get you through. Amen? Keep on walking with it. You keep on following him, and he will reveal himself to you. And listen to me, it may not turn out the way you wanted it to. And guess what? You're going to be faced with a decision. Amen. You can either quit in the midst of the race, or you can say, okay, God, whether or not I get it the way that I want it, I'm still going to serve you.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Amen.
Or you can try to create your own situation. You can say, I'm going to serve you, but yet at the same time, I'm going to make something happen that I want to happen. Good luck with that. good luck with that, buddy. Go ahead and operate in your flesh and see what you get out of that deal, because you will be miserable. Trust me.
It will set you back.
Sir?
It will set you back.
That's right. It will set you back. That's exactly right. It will set you back. And you may, sometimes people don't always make it back.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
But that doesn't, but God knows the heart. Amen? And he knows how to minister to people's hearts. Praise God. Even whenever we make mistakes,
right.
He's faithful and he's merciful.
Amen?
Amen? Everybody has a right, hallelujah, to hear this gospel message, Timothy. Let the gift that was placed in you be stirred up. I'm not going to be able to finish this message this morning, but we're going to try to go through each chapter at least and see what the Apostle Paul had to say. Let's go to chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 2. He goes on to say, "And the things that you have heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also." We're still talking about the gospel here. Come on, Timothy. Get the gift stirred up in you, son. Don't walk in fear and timidity. Let God fill you up. You have a gospel to preach. Every man, woman, and child has a right to hear it. And he said this. He said, "The things that you heard from me, Timothy, I need you to begin to preach that. But not only that, I need you to commit it to faithful men." Praise God. See, that's the truth. God will call other men in a congregation. God will call other men in a congregation. Congregation, and he will set his anointing upon them. And it's going to be Timothy's responsibility. The Lord will let you see it. The Lord will show you. When you're a preacher of the gospel, the Lord will show you other people that have been called to preach the gospel. And the Apostle Paul saying, you need to be willing to share the gospel with anybody. You need to be willing to take the time to share the truth with anybody that's hungry for it. But you really need to commit yourself to people that will also be able to teach others. Amen. You'll know whenever somebody's able to teach others, because the Holy Spirit is going to move upon their heart. They're going to be talking to people in public. They're going to be sharing the gospel with people in public. They're going to be studying to show themselves approved. And hallelujah, what the Apostle Paul saying is, I'm about to go to the chopping block. I'm not going to be here forever. Timothy, whenever I'm gone, then the mantle is going to be passed to you. It's your responsibility to preach the gospel. It's your responsibility to make sure that other men of the gospel learn the gospel so that they might preach the truth. You need to be aware there's Alexander the coppersmiths out there all over the place. They're going to withstand your words. They're going to come against your doctrine. They're going to call you a liar. They're going to call the people that sit in that you're a cult. They're going to say all kinds of things about you. But the reality of it is this is the truth, and it must go forward.
Amen.
Because people have
Amen.
A right
Amen.
To be
Amen.
Set free from the bondage of the enemy. Praise God.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
In verses 8 and 10, he says, "Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel." That's the message that I preach, Timothy. Jesus Christ, the seed of David, the promised one. You remember that, Timothy? You've been reading the Old Testament scriptures from your youth. God promised Messiah would come, and he told us he would come from not only the tribe of Judah, but also the seed of David. He is the manifested one, and he is the one who was raised from the dead. He conquered death, hell, and the grave. He goes on to say, "Wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto these bonds, but the word of God is not bound."
Amen.
Hallelujah. I might be stuck to a shackle and a chain, but the word of God is not bound, for it is alive and it's powerful and it's sharper than a two-edged sword. Amen. And it reaches into the hearts of men. No matter where they are, just one word spoken by the gospel of Jesus Christ can transform a life. A seed planted can produce a harvest in the life. He says, "Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory." He was talking about you. The elect's sake, eklektos. We've talked about this before. It's where we get our word election. Ek is out, and lektos is where we get the idea of election. And so it means chosen out ones. That's literally what the word means, chosen out. Chosen out of what? Chosen out of the ways of the world, chosen out of the lies of Satan, the bondage that the enemy placed humanity into from their first birth of Adam. The elect say, those who will be chosen out. See, some people take this as meaning predestination or eternal secure life. In other words, God said, you get to go. But that's not what it's saying. God chose man out through his eternal redemption plan. God knows each and every person who will receive the truth, but he didn't preordain those which would and those which wouldn't. Amen. He says, I have a plan. That plan's going to be preached. And people are going to have the opportunity with their free will to choose that plan and for them to be able to be saved. And the Apostle Paul is saying, because of the elect's sake, those who will choose the gospel when they hear it, I will suffer and endure these afflictions. Young Timothy, you need to understand that you also need to suffer and endure these afflictions. Let's go to chapter 3. Chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Still talking about the gospel here. This whole letter is written about the gospel and Timothy and the importance of Timothy preaching this gospel. He says, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, and unholy. If you skip down to verse 13 through 15, it says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. It's going to get worse, Timothy. You think it's bad right now? You think people like Alexander the Coppersmith are bad right now? It's just going to get worse. And he goes on to say this, deceiving and being deceived. They're going to be seducers. Times are going to be perilous. It's going to get worse. There's going to be people that are going to be deceiving people. And they themselves will be deceived. But continue thou in the things which you have learned and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Right. I see the Apostle Paul here as a father figure. Amen. He's like, I'm about to die, son. I see the tears in your eyes from the last time we embraced. I really want you to try to make it here. At the end of the letter, he says, please get here before winter, because if you don't make it before, then they're going to close the ports down. You're not going to get here. And it's not just because I need a cloak. I want to see you before I go. But I'm here to tell you, son, I'm about to go. And I think about a father, a true father or mother that has spent their time in their life pouring into their child the truth of the gospel and knowing that one day you're going to be on your own. One day it's going to be you and the Lord, and you're going to have to make a decision on who you're going to live for. And I hear the cry of Paul's heart as he says, it won't be long and I'm going to be gone and you're going to have decisions to make. And he goes on to say, and you need to remember that the word of God was implanted in you. And look what it says. The Holy Scriptures, they were able to make you wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Amen. The Scriptures make you wise. Not only will they lead you to salvation for eternal life, but they'll give you wisdom for today. Amen. On this pathway, in this journey, wherever you're facing, wherever you're going, the Scriptures will give you wisdom for today. Let's go to chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. And I'm going to close with this, and I think I'm going to finish it up tonight. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. He says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort, with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned to fables. It's going to get so bad, Timothy, that in the end, they're not going to want to hear the truth anymore. They're just going to want pleasant words spoken to them. They're not going to want to hear about the aspects of their life that don't line up according to the Scripture. But what I'm telling you to do is to preach the word, to be instant in season and out of season, to rebuke, to reprove. That word there really means to shine the light upon, to expose. There's things in God's word that must be preached. And when the truth of the gospel is preached, the light of the Holy Spirit is shown in the life and the person in the audience that hears it. And all of the sudden things in their life are exposed. When you read the scriptures, God will expose you. Amen. He will reveal, oh, the Lord's revealing to me. Something's not right in my life. Not only do we reprove and preach the truth and that it exposes things in our lives, but also we rebuke. Sometimes it's got a warning behind it. Because the truth of the matter is that just because things are exposed in our life, sometimes we don't listen to it. And what can happen is that this, either number one, you ain't saved, or number two, your conscience is becoming seared in that area of your life. Your heart is becoming hardened. Things have been, the Holy Spirit has repetitively showed you through the scriptures, through the preaching, through communication, whatever the case, something in your life isn't right. But at the same time, we harden our heart, we stiffen our neck, and the next thing you know, we become hardened, desensitized to that area of our life. Reprove, rebuke, but also exhort. See, not only that, but there's also a time for healing. Amen. Speak gentle words to the people, Timothy. Let them know that God will comfort you. God will heal you. God loves you. Listen to me. God's been dealing with a disobedient people for a long time. And he still loves them. And he's long-suffering. And he's patient with his people. And he's merciful with them. But Timothy, it's your job to preach the truth. And in the end, they will not endure sound doctrine.